Lives Matter, where this world will be magnified from the pulpit all the way to the sidewalk, and we pray for the neighborhood supernaturally, because God said his word will not go out and return unto him void. So let us open our spirits and our hearts to this woman of God, Eliza, minister, evangelist, Eliza.
Okay, this passage of scripture is very important. 39 verses and hear them all. But something is recorded more than one time in the Bible. There is something significant about the text. And our message today is that place, this place. In this passage of scripture, we see a man. We don't know if this man is a young man, a middle-aged man, or an old man. We don't know if this man is married or single. We don't know if this man is educated or illiterate. But we do see that this man has a problem.
Yes.
I started wondering what was wrong with this man. The Bible said this man was living in tombs. And the tombs in the now, you know, it was the cemetery or the graveyard. How many people would want to live in a cemetery or a graveyard? He was in the tomb where dead people are. He had little or no contact with his family or friends. He was living in a place of no hope. Helplessness,
yeah.
Depression, anguish. Anger and fear. I was reading a book by Bishop T.D. Jakes who was talking about Deion Sanders. And it was that Deion Sanders, he lived near a graveyard. And every time he would walk by the graveyard, he would run because, you know, most people will think about a graveyard, think about ghosts and goblins and being scared. Look at this man. We have a man who's living in the tombs, living in a cemetery. God was so devastating in his life that he was living there in the, by himself in the tomb. And the first negative preach last Sunday about being betrayed and broken, I saw this man as being betrayed, broken, and abused. He could have been mental abuse. You know, our children, our their parents might tell them that, you know, you're not going to be anything. You're less like your parents, and he ain't nothing. So you know, he was a not abused mentally. He might have been abused physically, but somebody was always fighting with them. You know, and always just doing mean things. So I know a person who, when he was a young one, he told me that he was whipped alive with a belt, and he had so much anger in him that when he saw that person assault somebody who did things like this person did. He hit a wall one time with a big hole in that. That's how frustrated he was, you know? But we get frustrated sometimes in our life. Not only he might have been physically abused, thank you, but he probably could have been sexually abused. And you know, with him being a man, we hear a whole lot about women being abused. When you think about a man, you know this man's supposed to be a macho man. And think about he might have been sexually abused as a child or as a teenager. That's guilt, that's shame that's on his life.
That's right.
Oh my God.
That's right.
He might have been socially abused. He might have had that education to advance on his job. But because he wasn't the right kind of person, even a female, sometimes we don't advance on a job because we're not the right person that they want. So he could have been socially abused. And not only that, he might have been spousal abused. That, you know, that goes on too. And spousal abuse, if you're a man and you know that your wife is out there beating on you, saying mean things to you, you know, it's all that frustration going on. He was in the tomb trying to avoid thinking or talking about his abuse or trauma. He was in the tombs trying to avoid places, activities, or people that reminded him of his abuse.
Alright.
He was in the tomb because he did not have a positive or good self-esteem about himself. He felt hopeless about his future. He lacked interest in activity that he used to have a dollar punch, but you know, like some men, they like to look at the football games and do this and that, but he lost interest because of all that agony, the hurt that he was going through. Uh-huh. He also once, let's enjoy a lot of things for life, and he was feeling emotionally numb. We get to that place sometimes when we get hurt, and we don't want to be around other people, so we shield ourselves. We put a wall in front of us. If I could just shield myself, I'm not going to really hurt anymore. Uh-huh. There was nobody there to help defend him, to protect him, to talk to him, to show him that he is someone special. A person who is in isolation has a feeling of being defeated. This is the time that Satan plays on our mind. We know that Satan abuses our mind. It's a playground for Satan. He talks to us and tells us things that we were hurt. We have repeats of things in our lives that it crippled us. He was in the tomb. So didn't want to be around the man because he didn't want to feel insignificant. We felt it insignificant as it is, but fearing not other people made it worse. The next verse said, the people that battled him with shouts and chains. And the people were afraid of him because, you know, he was so strong. And he got agitated. And you remember the TV program that came on called Incredible Hulk?
Yeah.
And you know, he was mild-mannered. But every time something upset him, he got full super strength. So we see this man got super strength. Broke those chains and the feeling of guilt and shame, the consequence, why is this happening to me. I just can't cope with life. He is yelling because he is looking for relief. We have men and women today, young and old, rich and poor, and every nationality that is going through the same thing that this man is going through. Oh Lord, we have many people who's in that place. Where is that place? That place is where fear is.
Yes.
It's where anger is.
Uh-huh.
Where drug and alcohol abuse is.
Yes.
There's where pain is. Where hopelessness is.
Yes.
Where helplessness is. Where you feel bound. Where you feel weak. Where you feel hatred.
Yes.
When you feel hurt.
Yes.
When you feel sickness. When you feel defeated.
Uh-huh.
When you feel isolated. Well, thank God, we got some bad names.
Yes,
we can thank God that we don't have to stay in that place. There's a man named Jesus who loves us. This man named
Jesus
came to our rescue. All we got to do is think about the women at the well in John 4:4. It said Jesus had a need to go to Samaria. Jesus had a need to go where that man was, but we have problems in our life. Jesus has a need to come to our life. Oh, yes, he does. And he will come to see the light. I can tell you something about it. Now, in North Dakota, have a hard time there, feeling like all hope was gone. I feel that, Lord, what's going to happen then? There, with my sister, had found a job in 2 months. Oh, Lord, have mercy. I said, I'm a burden on my sister. What shall I do about it? Oh, Lord, I was crying. The Lord said, you remember when you came to North Dakota, there was 2 rainbows in the sky. And we know the rainbows are a promise of blessings. So he saw that he know that he was not going to leave me alone. And then the next day he told me that you're going to tell people that I am a deliverer.
Oh,
that I'm obeying me. When I was like Sarah that time, I started laughing. I said, I'm here. I'm in this situation. And you're trying to tell me that one day I'm going to be able to tell people that you're a deliverer. Oh, but I saw God move. Yes, he did.
Yeah.
I got a job. But then I went to a psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist said, what's going on? And I was telling the things that happened in my life. And I told him the things that are happening now. And so he said, have you ever been to a mental institution? I said, no, sir. He said, have you ever taken the type of the drugs or for the control your mind, and, you know, keep it calm and all that? He said, no, sir. He said, you're amazing. And I can't believe that you're not somewhere. Oh, Lord, have mercy. That's a mental institution.
Come on.
So Jesus asked him, what is your name? And he said, my name is Legion because there are many of us. Oh, Lord, you know what? The Lord showed me something. There's a lady, a real lady.
Oh, yeah.
Her name is Judy Chase. She had a whole lot of things that happened to her when she was a little girl.
Yeah.
She had been sexually abused. She had been physically abused. Oh, Lord, have mercy. And she went to see a doctor. And you know what? They found out she had 95 personality. This
morning, and I am just, hallelujah, happy as my husband would say. I couldn't be happier, and just praise God for this. Thank you, Lord. Yeah.